Hey everyone, welcome to this new tutorial. Well, we'll be going over some advanced development techniques in C# Unity. For starters, this is not clickbait, and there is a reason why you won't see this knowledge into game dev tutorials. Game dev tutorials are obviously more geared towards game dev. But of course, this means that if you are self-taught, most people take a long time to go outside of this game dev bubble of tutorials to go and learn advanced C# code. I myself never learned this till I actually did it in school and got a job in game development. And by the time I was already pretty experienced, but I just had no clue it existed. This tutorial is more aimed at the intermediate level, but this will also have some value for beginners. But of course, I really recommend you to understand things like functions and properties and variables. I recommend anyone watching this to first just look and listen to what I have to say. And after that, maybe start over, but this time following along for the best results and actually understanding what I'm gonna teach you. Also, after doing these things, I recommend you to always think about how to apply these techniques in your own games and your own code. Because mastering this will take time and experience, and nothing in code you will just master by watching a video. I also have a download link for the entire project in the description. For if you might stumble across some problems, I also heavily commented this to make sure that everything is understandable, even if you have questions. You can always go there and check it out. If you know any other developers who could use some new game dev skills, feel free to share this video. I would really appreciate it, and it would really help me out and the channel a lot. Also, a big shout out to Cyanel Alejandro for suggesting this video. Suggestions for tutorials are always really appreciated in the comment section below, and it really helped me out with making good content people would need. With that out of the way, let's get right into this video, and I hope I'll be able to teach you something. Alright everyone, let's get right into it. So what I will be teaching you is I'll be teaching serializables, classes, static classes, and enums. These are the four things I'll be teaching you in this tutorial. Of course, if you have suggestions or questions about things or how I would do something, you can always leave them in the comment section below. So, the only actual object we will use in this scene will be a game object named manager. And I will also create another game object, but we won't be having it in the scene, and this will be a sprite. The sprite, I'll just call it new sprite, and I'll go to sprite and I'll give it a knob. I'll also make it 5 by 5 by 5, and I will move this into our assets, and I will move it from our scene. This will be basically now a prefab I obviously can use whenever I need it to. This is actually all the setup we will be needing into this project. I will now create my first script, and I will call this the manager. Alright, so our script is created, and we will start instantly by making serializables. I will remove these things, and instead I will create a I will first go to using, and then we will use system. Why we will be using system? Because we want to use serializables, and otherwise you can't use them. So I will now create serializable, and now we will actually already create our first class. And for this class, I will go public class, and I will call it block setup. If you don't understand it yet, don't worry, we'll get to it. Now I will give it a public value, a game object named block. If you are experienced with game development, you should probably understand these properties already. I will also use a public color 32, which I'll call color. This will obviously be used to get a color. And I will also set up public vector3, and this will be spawn pos. And this is going to be where the object obviously is going to spawn. Right now, nothing will happen if I just obviously just go here and I go to the manager. You will see that nothing is happening. First, because the manager isn't in the manager yet, and the second, because we didn't serialize it yet. This is now an object. So this is an entire object, just like GameObject. You see they have the same color. That's because they're the same thing. A color is a class, GameObject is a class, a vector tree is a class. So what we can do now is we can do use serialized field. You can also use public, but like I explained in my last tutorials, I prefer serialized field. And we will go serialized field block setup. And now default and I'll call default blocks. And I will now go once again to my Unity, and you will see that I have a default block. I can now add a game object to it, a color to it, make sure that you also put the alpha to max, otherwise you can see, and a spawn position to it. This is fine. If you do want to do one, this is way too advanced for just one block. But we want to make this into an array because we want to spawn multiple blocks. And now you can see, if we let it load, we can now declare a size. So let's say I want to spawn 4 blocks. There are now 4 blocks. Of course, this is a knob, but that doesn't matter. So I will declare all of these things. I will just drag and drop the knob into the block section. I will also give them all a color. This one is going to be red. This one is going to be yellow. Make sure to put the alpha to the max, because by default it's way below. Also add a blue one. And I will also add a green one. This one doesn't have alpha, don't forget it. Now I will go to the X and Y values. I will just give it like some random values, so we can see where everything spawns. Minus 10 and minus 10. Currently, this nothing is going to happen, but what we will be doing is we will basically be filling this class up with different values, and we will make multiple values. We now have a size of 4, so that means there are four objects with this data inside. What we can do now is we can create. Go, for example, start. Oh, it's not static, that's for later. Void start, there we go. And we can say instantiate, and then we can say default block, default blocks, and we will say default blocks 0.block. We can also say default blocks dot, oh, it's dot dot zero dot spawn pos, and then we just say quaternion dot identity, and we can actually, I think we can just do it like this. We can also say get component sprite ren. No, that doesn't work like that. And now we can now use this to basically instantiate a block. So if I now start the scene, this block should be spawned because I took the data from this block. So if I click start and it renders, you can see that there is a knob and it spawned at 0.5x5. Let's see. There we go, 5x5, because that's what we put in the first one. Of course, if I say that this has to be 1 and this is 1, it will take the data for the second one. What we can do now is loop through all of these 4 elements and get the data out of them and spawn them all. Of course, we are not done yet, and we will take this one step further. We will create a second script, and we will call this the block manager. And now we will use the same class things we did before, but this time we will be using it to actually create a block class. And this will basically be an object that is a block. So This time we will remove everything and we will write namespace. And we will call this block manager. And a namespace basically serves as a connection. Everything in the block manager will be accessible if we go to our script where we want to access it, and we will say using block manager. And now we can access the block manager from this script. We will now create a public class block, and we will now create another class that will basically serve as a block. We will now go, we will create a property, we will create two properties. We can, you can write pop and press tab twice to basically do it for you, and we will make it hold a game object. I will call this block object, and we will create another prop and we will call it color 32, and we will of course block color. Currently like this, these are the properties that will once again be hold. This is something like this, but this time with some special parameters, which I won't explain to you now because then it would actually take a little bit longer, and of course tutorials have to be snappy. Also make sure that this actually functions as a function, so you need to actually have it an uppercase. Right now the block is not accessible, or I assume it's not. It is, but you can't do anything with it. What we can do is we can say public, and we can call the name of block, and then we can say like this. Now we have, now this block is accessible, and if we want to use this to basically create new blocks, we can say game object obj color 32 color and vector 3 spawn pos. Now you can see that we have parameters we can put into the block. If I'm now going to say block object, so basically this is equal to obj, the block object will be stored into this class. Well, I will also do the same for the color, so I'll go block color is equal to color, and now I will do obj.getComponent sprite renderer, because I will now get the sprite renderer of the object, and I will say dot color is equal to block color, because now I can actually reach it. Now one more thing, because of course we want to instantiate the block, and we will go do this by game object dot instantiate. When you're using classes, you have to add game object before it, because game, otherwise it's a mono behavior thing you can't just reach from a class, or I would have to do double punt mono behavior, and that could actually mess things up, but now I shouldn't have to use it. But we're not doing that because it's not needed, and this will actually be bad code if I would, and my boss would probably kill me for it. Block object, because it, like you know how to instantiate block pos. Spawn pos, and quaternion dot identity, because it's of course not going to be rotated. Currently we are instantiating the block. So if I'm now going to remove this, and I will say new block, because we are creating a new block, and we will go like this, we can say default blocks 0 dot block, and default blocks once again 0 dot color, and default blocks dot zero dot spawn pos, We will now take once again the first part of the block we gave it, like the first data, so this data, but this time we will go through the class and we will basically create a new block object with it. And now this will do exactly the same thing, but then through a class. Currently, this looks kinda useless. This is way too OP for, like, this is way too advanced code to just spawn blocks. But when you go more advanced, this is the way you do things. No, of course we want, why are we doing it in an array and not just like spamming the four blocks every time? Well, that's kinda obvious, like for me. Probably for most of you too, because we can make this into an array, so we can have multiple blocks. And now we can simply do for each, and then we can just go block, a block, and then we go in, this is by the way wrong, I need to say block setup, wait, block setup, block in, default blocks, and then we can say new block, so we will create a new block, and we can now say block.block, block.color, and of course block.spawnPause. And if I'm gonna remove maximize and play, you can see that right now it will loop through all of the object and will take all the data. I told you not to this. And it will just take all the data and it will now spawn on the different places you inserted. That's pretty nice. I mean, especially for now, this part is really handy when you need to send multiple parameters to, for example, different enemies. We will now amp things up a notch and we will do something new. We will now do static classes and we will use this to hold block stats. This will be a pretty simple script, but you will definitely get the point. I will now go to block stats and I will create a new script named block stats. Block stats will once again hold the names, will once again be in the namespace of block manager, but this time we will use this to hold the amount of blocks alive. What this means is, of course, we will create a public static class block stats. Static is required to basically make it easily accessible from everywhere. That's the simplest way I can say it. There's of course much more to it, but that's the basics. We will now set two parameters. Oh, actually we will for now do one and we will get back to this. We will say property, and this time we will set static before we actually add something, int, and then we say blocks alive, and this will hold the amount of blocks alive. Of course, like you see, this isn't really important, because sometimes you need to know how many blocks there are alive, but for this tutorial I just want to show you how this works. Right now I can go to block manager or manager and I can say block stats dot blocks alive plus plus. And now, every time a new block spawns, it will send a new one point to this place. So if I'm now after the start function, do debug.log, not log error, block stats dot blocks alive, obviously it's going to send me 4. And there we go, it says that there are 4 blocks alive. Well, I know they're circles, but I'm calling them blocks. You know what, because I can't handle this, Let's go real quick. Nope, and it's now a block. Nah. It's a block now. Alright, so we now went over serializables, static classes, and classes. There's now one more thing I want to teach you, and that's enums. And enums is a pretty nice feature. I will go to the block manager and I will create a public enum colors. And what we will do is we will lock the player into which colors you can have. So I'll go with yellow, comma, green, comma, red, comma, blue. Like you see, you just write down names. We will now switch things up a little, because now we have this colors value, so we don't need the literal color anymore. So we will instead call it colors. And now you can see it will now be using this enum. You can already instantly see that there's an error over here, because of course this doesn't want an enum, this wants a color 32. So we will go here and we will say colors. So now it's going to be using colors. Of course, once again an error, but this is a difficult one, so we will get back to that and we will be using our static class for that. We will now go to blockColors.color and it will basically take the colors. So if we will go to the manager now, you can see that right now there is, instead of colors, if I saved it. Oh, it's giving me an error. Oops. Alright, so I got an error. I forgot this one. I'm going to comment this one out for now, because otherwise it's not going to work and I can't show you. There we go. And we now can choose which color we want it to have. We want this one to be yellow, this one to be green, this one to be red, and this one to be blue. And note, it's not gonna know that yellow means the color yellow. I mean, that would be way too smart for a computer. So what we will be doing is we won't be adding the block color to color. No, we will do something much cooler. We will go to the static manager and we will create a convert to color. So we will basically make a function that will take this data we added over here and say yellow means RGB 255,255,0,255. How will we do this? We will first create a public static color 32, because it will return the color we need, and we'll call this convert to color, and we will use colors, so basically our colors enum, and we'll call this colors, of course, and we now have a function we can call whenever we want. So if we now go to this and we will say, instead of this enum, convert stats block stats dot convert to color, and if we input color into that, we will basically go to the enum. This will be the enum. For example, this will be yellow. This will go yellow. This you will put in yellow into the convert color. Now we will create a switch over here. Wait, I'll first create a color 32 color, because otherwise we have nothing to store it inside. I'll also put this to, no, I don't need to. Alright, so now I'll be showing you a nice trick how to do this real fast. I will write down switch, I'll press tab, I'll press tab again, I'll press colors, now I will press enter, and everything gets filled in for me. Now I will be able to just say color is equal to new color 32. So this is basically yellow. And now I will just quickly fill in all the RGB values. Alright, I got the RGB values done. Pause real quick if you don't have it yet. And now we will of course return color, which will basically say that convert to color is color. Wait, and you also have to put color to a value before you actually, there we go, comma 255. You have to give it a value, otherwise it might crash and it doesn't like that. So it also needs something to return. So like you see, we will put in the enum, it will check what the enum means, and based on what the enum means, it will give back a color value. Now we will go back and you can see that this doesn't give an error anymore. This will now give take the block color, set the block color to the right thing, and it's supposed to work now. We now have a nice enum that basically does everything for us. And we now need to check if it all works, because we now have used dropdowns, and like you see, it still works and it's now using an enum. So for example, if I would like say this has to be blue and this has to be yellow, we can just do that and we don't have to rechange all of the values all the time. We can just use an enum and do it for us. Now there's one more thing I want to show you, and that's once again a little bit advanced, but like we are learning only advanced stuff of course. Alright, so there's one more thing I want to show you, and that is using overrides to basically override some default functions that are used within Unity, or actually within C#. So let's say we will create a block B, and we will store this into B. For example, you can store whatever you want in it, like it has to be a block. And at the end, we want to see the data of the last block. We can do debug.log, we all should know about this, B, and now we should be able to get something. No, because it's still an object, we want to do it to string. And now we should get something, right? But we won't be getting what we want to see. Oh, and we also have to make sure that it has a value, so I'll put it to 0 for now, so null. So B, a dot to string, but currently toString doesn't know what to do with it. It will basically say it will output block manager dot block, and that's it, because he doesn't know any better. What we can do is we can go public override, and we will override toString, and now if we do toString, we can say a dollar sign the last block you spawn had the RGB values of block color. And now we have a toString override, so we overwrote the toString function, and now if we go debug.log and we will go to play, it will now say the last block you spawned had the RGB values of RGBA 0,0255255, which is the yellow one, I think. Is it the yellow one? Oh no, it's a blue one. Huh? That's confusing. Oh yeah, it's right. Oops. And then there's like one last thing I want to show you, just to like share a little bit more insight on what you can do, is you can also add another one. Let's say we want to just create a block, but just some default values. So if I go block without parameters, this works. What we can do now is we can create in block stats, we can create one more static void. And there's one more static game object, and this will be public static game object, and we'll call it default block get development set. There we go. This is now a default block. What we can do with this is we can upfront store a block inside of there. So I will go serialized field. Game object default. Block, of course, I can just say default. Default block. I can now go into block stats dot default block, and I can say default block. I now have the default block stored into block stats, and now I can say, if I just call block without any parameters, I will basically say new block. Now I will say block stats dot default block, because it needs a default block. Then I can say colors dot, and we will say as a default it's going to be green, and as a spawn pulse I can say new vector tree, and I will say 0, 0, 0. And now I can just say, hey, I want to be lazy, and I just want to say new block. And there we go. We now also can spawn it like this. Of course, it's giving me one more error. I need to put this. Now we can once again assign a new block. There we go. We now have a default block. I will just assign it. And like you see, now it will also put a green block in the center without me having to add parameters to it. There it is, the last block. And I'm pretty sure that's it for this video. Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope I was able to learn you something. Feedback is greatly welcome, and definitely give me suggestions in the comment section down below. And I will see you again very soon. Bye.